living word families and friends here in Silver Spring, Maryland, and all around the world, it's so good to have you with us for our Good Friday service. We know that times are precarious as we're physically separated by distance. And for some of us, we're walking to what it feels like a valley of illness, or we've even experienced the loss of a loved one at this time. Just know we're also very proud of each of you for setting aside this time during the Passover season, the Passion Week, to reflect on the one created to bring us all together despite the physical separation. We know this Good Friday program will minister to you and your families through scripture, commentary, video, and songs. Some of you may even recognize fellow congregants participating from their homes, kind of like the first century church. Though we're apart, we know the Holy Spirit, despite all that, will tie it all together in the end. At the conclusion, we'll even take communion together. You and I've got my matzah here, I've got my juice. So you may want to think about what you can grab right now for the bread and the juice in your own homes. It doesn't have to be fancy or perfect. It's the act of participation in remembering the Lord Jesus Christ as he asked us to. So relax, settle in, open your mind, spirit, heart, and soul to receive all he has for you this hour. Claim it for you and your households. In the name of Jesus, amen.
6 days before the Passover, Jesus went to Bethany, the home of Lazarus, the man he had raised from death. They prepared a dinner for him there, which Martha helped serve. Lazarus was one of those who were sitting at the table with Jesus. Then Mary took a whole pint of a very expensive perfume made of pure nard, poured it on Jesus' feet, and wiped them with her hair. The sweet smell of the perfume filled the whole house. One of Jesus' disciples, Judas Iscariot, the one who was going to betray him, said,
"Why wasn't this perfume sold for 300 silver coins? And the money given to the poor?"
He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. He carried the money bag and would help himself from it.
"Leave her alone. Let her keep what she has for the day of my burial. You will always have poor people with you, but you will not always have me."
My focus is on Matthew 26, when Jesus and his disciples are already in the Passover feast, and this woman comes with her alabaster jar to anoint Jesus' feet. It is a beautiful expression of worship. It reminds me that in this season, we have so much time to express our worship to God as well. We can sing, dance, write poetry, anything in a way that we can lavish our love on him as well. I thank God not only for him keeping us, but for the sacrifice of his son. I'm reminded that he has kept us throughout this pestilence, and he can continue to do the same because he is still the same God. It reminds me of what it says in verse 13 in this passage. "I tell you the truth, wherever the good news is preached throughout the world, this woman's deeds will be remembered and discussed." May we find worship in the same way, where we can love on God and give him all of the glory and all of the praise in this season.
I've come to pour my praise on him, like all from Mary's alabaster box. Don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and I dry them with my hair. You weren't there the night he found me. You did not feel what I felt when he wrapped his love all around me. And you don't know the cost of the oil in my alabaster bottle. Forget the way life used to be. I was a prisoner to the sin that had me bound. I spent my days, poured my life without measure into a little treasure box. Jesus came to me and healed my soul with the wonder of his touch. So now I'm giving back to him all the praise he's worthy of. I've been forgiven, and that's why I love him so much. And don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and dry them with my hair. You are there the night Jesus found me. You did not feel what I felt when he wrapped his loving arms around me.
Jesus and his disciples were at supper. The devil had already put into the heart of Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, the thought of betraying Jesus.
I'm telling you the truth. One of you is going to betray me.
The disciples looked at one another, completely puzzled about whom he meant. One of the disciples, the one whom Jesus loved, was sitting next to Jesus. Simon Peter motioned to him.
Ask him whom he is talking about.
So that disciple moved closer to Jesus' side.
Who is it, Lord?
I will dip some bread in the sauce and give it to him. He is the man.
So he took a piece of bread, dipped it, and gave it to Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot. As soon as Judas took the bread, Satan entered into him.
Hurry. And do what you must.
None of the others at the table understood why Jesus said this to him. Since Judas was in charge of the money bag, some of the disciples thought that Jesus had told him to go and buy what they needed for the festival, or to give something to the poor. Judas accepted the bread and went out at once. It was night.
As Jesus has sensed that this is the final hour for which he was sent to this world to bring salvation to us sinners. And he celebrates the feast of the Passover with his disciples, and he's instructing them on what things to come. And he is fully realizing that he is to be betrayed by his own disciple, Judas, and he'll be denied by Peter, as he had told him that before the crowing of the cock in the morning, it's that he will deny him three times. And Peter, of course, did not agree with him. And as we see later on down the road, when Jesus is being trialed and the crowds are condemning him, even the crowds, those who were a few days before shouting Hosanna to the Son of David, and Hosanna in the highest, to the one who comes in the name of the Lord. And ultimately those crowds turn against him, and as did Peter, denied Jesus. And through all of this, you see nothing but the love pouring out of our Lord's hearts and eyes towards us. And ultimately, as he is crucified, he, someone said that he shed everything. He emptied himself on the cross for us, except of love. And that love still continues to cover us as he paid the ultimate sacrifice, the complete price for our sins, our transgressions on the cross. And we can surely take comfort in that, even in this times when we are going through the trials and many uncertainties, and people are turning to the Lord, looking to that cross, which is the symbol of our hope, even in these times. And the shed blood of Jesus has paid the price for all of us. So we thank and praise God for his death and resurrection and for his love.
After Jesus had said this prayer, he left with his disciples and went across Kidron Brook. There was a garden in that place, and Jesus and his disciples went in. Judas, the traitor, knew where it was, because many times Jesus had met there with his disciples. So Judas went to the garden, taking with him a group of Roman soldiers and some temple guards sent by the chief priests and the Pharisees. They were armed and carried lanterns and torches. Jesus knew everything that was going to happen to him, so he stepped forward and asked them,
"Who is it you are looking for?"
"Jesus of Nazareth."
Judas the traitor was standing there with them when Jesus said to them,
"I am he."
They moved back and fell to the ground. Again, Jesus asked them,
"Who is it you are looking for?"
"Jesus of Nazareth."
"I have already told you that I am he. If then you are looking for me, let these others go."
He said this so that what he had said might come true. "Father, I have not lost even one of those you gave me." Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's slave, cutting off his right ear. The name of the slave was Malchus.
"Put your sword back in its place."
"Do you think that I will not drink the cup of suffering which my father has given me?"
Then the Roman soldiers, with their commanding officer and the Jewish guards, arrested Jesus, tied him up, and took him first to Annas. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had advised the Jewish authorities that it was better that one man should die for all the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. That other disciple was well known to the high priest, so he went with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest's house, while Peter stayed outside by the gate. Then the other disciple went back out, spoke to the girl at the gate, and brought Peter inside.
"Aren't you also one of the disciples of that man?"
"No, I'm not."
It was cold, so the servants and guards had built a charcoal fire and were standing around it, warming themselves. So Peter went over and stood with them, warming himself. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. Jesus answered,
"I have always spoken publicly to everyone. All my teaching was done in the synagogues and in the temple where all the people come together. I have never said anything in secret. Why then do you question me?" "Question the people who heard me. Ask them what I told them. They know what I said."
"How dare you talk like that to the high priest?"
"If I have said anything wrong, tell everyone here what it was. But if I am right in what I have said, why do you hit me?"
Then Annas sent him, still tied up, to Caiaphas, the high priest. Peter was still standing there, keeping himself warm. So the others said to him, "Aren't you also one of the disciples of that man?"
"No, I am not."
But Peter denied it. One of the high priest's slaves, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, spoke up.
"Didn't I see you with him in the garden?"
"No."
And at once, a rooster crowed.
In Matthew 26, Jesus reminds us about a prophecy. It says, "I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered." Do we feel like these sheep right now? Scattered, not being able to see our families, not being able to go to church, or afraid to go outside? I would like to remind you that Jesus, our good shepherd, knows exactly how you feel. Jesus knows the fear of being separated from his Father. In verse 42, Jesus said to his Father, "Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away, may your will be done." On this Good Friday, can we say, "Father, no matter what our lives look like, thank you that we have a faithful Savior that drank from that cup of suffering for the forgiveness of our sin."
Early in the morning, Jesus was taken from Caiaphas' house to the governor's palace. The Jewish authorities did not go inside the palace, for they wanted to keep themselves ritually clean in order to be able to eat the Passover meal. So Pilate went outside to them and asked,
"What do you accuse this man of?"
"We would not have brought him to you if he had not committed a crime."
"Then you yourselves take him and try him according to your own law."
"We are not allowed to put anyone to death."
This happened in order to make come true what Jesus had said when he indicated the kind of death he would die. Pilate went back into the palace and called Jesus.
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
"Does this question come from you? Or have others told you about me?"
"Do you think I'm a Jew? It was your own people and the chief priests who handed you over to me. What have you done?"
"My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom belonged to this world, my followers would fight to keep me from being handed over to the Jewish authorities. No. My kingdom does not belong here."
"Are you a king, then?"
"You say that I am a king. I was born and came into the world for this one purpose: to speak about the truth. Whoever belongs to the truth listens to me."
"And what is truth?"
Jesus was arrested and taken to the home of Caiaphas, the high priest, where the teachers of religious law and the elders had gathered. They wanted to put Jesus to death with no proof of a crime. They were all full of pride with their titles, outward appearance of the law, but inwardly, spiritually void. They hid behind religion. They did not have the love of God in them. They asked Jesus if he was the Messiah, the Son of God. And he answered, "You said it. And in the future, you will see the Son of Man seated in the place of power at God's right hand and coming on the clouds of heaven." Many times we are blinded and deaf to the things of God that would change our actions in our lives. We are so set in doing things our own way. When Jesus was arrested, the other disciples fled. Peter followed Jesus after he was arrested. He kept his distance so when no one could identify him. I believe Peter was overwhelmed with fear. He was fearful for Jesus and he was fearful for his own life. Peter denied 3 times that he even knew Jesus. But I am sure you can actually relate to that. We are all like Peter, not perfect. We make mistakes. However, the opportunity to repent and to turn away from our sinful ways and let God use us in a powerful way as he did Peter.
It was at this time that Jesus stood before Pilate, the governor of the Roman province of Judea. And Pilate asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" And Jesus said, "It is as you said." Pilate, being the one in authority, was afraid of what the people would do if he did not give in to their demands. Wishing to satisfy the people, Pilate followed political expediency. Though he believed Jesus was innocent, Pilate followed political expediency rather than justice. Today, many are still giving people what they want and not what they need. We should not worry about what people think over what God thinks. We should put obeying God and following his plan above anything else in our lives. We can only do this when we tap into the power of God.
Then Pilate went back outside to the people and said to them,
I cannot find any reason to condemn him, but... according to the custom you have, I always set free a prisoner for you during the Passover. Do you want me to set free for you, the King of the Jews?
They answered him with a shout. Was a bandit.
We know that Jesus was not on trial and delivered to be crucified for any wrong or fault of his own. As it's written in the prophet Isaiah, chapter 53, verse 9, there was no violence in him, nor was there any deceit in his mouth. But instead, it was at the shouting of the people that Pilate asked him, who do you want me to release to you, Jesus or Barabbas? Let me suggest to you that I believe it seems the injustice that was served to Jesus was for an opportunity for God to show his amazing grace for the entire world. A Day of Atonement was written about in Leviticus chapter 16. The priest of the law of Moses would make an atonement for the sins of the people using two goats. One goat was called a scapegoat, and the other goat was a goat without sin, without blemish. The scapegoat would have their sins, would have sins of the people transferred onto him as the priests put their hands on the goat, and that goat was released and freed into the wilderness. The goat without sin was used as a sacrifice in its blood to purify the people for their sins. Now, doesn't that sound familiar? Jesus and Barabbas play the part of these two goats. Barabbas represents spiritually the scapegoat that had all of the sins and was released to go, while Jesus, being a lamb without blemish, without sin, was sacrificed and crucified, and his blood was shed for our atonement and our purification. And that truly is amazing grace.
It is important to remember one fact. that our Lord Jesus Christ endured the cross and went all the way with the cross for you and I. He endured the pain. He endured the suffering. He endured all the beating that was put on him. And he did it for us, for you and I. And regardless of your nationality, regardless of your race, your color, whether you are rich, whether you are poor, whether you are old or whether you are young, it does not matter. You know, whether you've been away from him for so long, it doesn't matter. He did it for you. And as we celebrate this Good Friday, this is the time to come back home. For he laid down his life for you and I, so that we can experience the love of the Father, so that we can experience forgiveness of the Father. So this is the time to lay down everything for him, for he laid down his life for us.
Jerusalem that day, the soldiers tried to clear the narrow street, but the crowd pressed in to see the man condemned to die on Calvary. He was bleeding from a beating. There were stripes upon his back, and he wore a crown of thorns upon his head, and he bore with every step the scorn of those who cried out for his death. Down the Via Dolorosa, all the way of suffering, like a lamb came the Messiah, the King. Though he chose to walk that road out of his love for you, for me. Down the Via Dolorosa, all the way to Calvary. Though the crowd rested to see him, he did not for mercy cry. He looked down through eyes of love for you and me. And the pain he would endure would pay the price of sin upon that tree. Down the Via Dolorosa, all the way of suffering, like a lamb came the Messiah, Christ the King. So he chose to walk that road out of his love for you, for me. Down the Via Dolorosa, all the way to Calvary. The blood that would cleanse the souls of all men made its way to the heart of Jerusalem. Down the Via Dolorosa, all the way of suffering,
Via Dolorosa, the road he was not forced to walk on, but the road he was born to walk on and willingly walked on. Like Jesus, you and I are walking on our separate roads, right? And it's not an easy road for either one of us. It's long, it's full of surprises, and in fact now, it's as if everyone is in a complete fog. All you see ahead of you is fog. You can't see what's coming next around the corner, but he is there through it. He forged it, he created it, and he's walking by your side in addition to knowing what's in front of you. He's saying, come on, I'll walk it with you. Come on. You know, the Beatles, the famous rock group, they had it right with their famous song, The Long and Winding Road. It's not a hymn, but for this moment, it's pretty applicable. It goes something like this. The long and winding road that leads to your door will never disappear. Oh, I've seen that road before. Don't leave me standing here. Help me find my way. Now, regardless of my voice, the point of this song is he's here. He's found the way for you. He is the way. It's no accident you're watching now. And if you're willing to walk that road with him instead of choosing to the one that you forged for yourself, a road of aloneness, I invite you to pray this prayer with me now. In fact, everyone watching, let's all pray together right now in one name, one Holy Spirit right now. Just believe this in your heart. Speak it with your mouth, confessing it as we pray it. God, I'm on a road that's tough, it's lonely, and it's sometimes downright frightening. I can't do it anymore. I just don't have it in me. I'm tired. I've made mistakes. I've treated others poorly along the way, even been prideful. Not only walking the road before me, but trying to forge it in my own way, a different direction, away from you, God, and others. But I'm willing to believe you, that you sent your son, Jesus, to help me, to walk with me, to walk down the road ahead of me. Forgive me of my hard, even sarcastic attitude to do it all alone. I've sinned and made errors like everyone else, but I'm not looking behind me. I'm now looking ahead. I'm grabbing your hand, Lord, to lead me out of the fog and lead me out of the loneliness to walk beside you. I thank you that my road doesn't lead to death, but to eternal life, as Jesus died and rose again, plowing the way for me because you loved me. I receive you as my Father, your Son as my Savior, and your Holy Spirit particularly as my guide from the road of isolation and death to the one of resurrection and life for eternity. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, if you prayed that, never having done that before, choosing a different road to walk it with Jesus, we welcome you to the family of God. We're really excited for you. And now we'd like to take communion with you, because Good Friday includes what the Lord Jesus Christ did with his disciples, which was having that last Passover meal with his friends, the people he mentored. And part of that was the bread and the wine. So now is a great time. Grab your bread. I have my matzah here. And I want you to take a look at this. It's perforated. This is the kind of bread that they do use for Passover, and the perforation symbolizes the piercing that Jesus went through on the cross, that actual piercing of his hands and feet according to Psalm 22 and of course in the book of Isaiah. Now, I want to pause here a moment because Psalm 22 used to bother me because it started out with Jesus saying on the cross, my God, why have you forsaken me? And that upsets me, it might upset you, but you need to know this. That was a quote of the first verse of Psalm 22. He was quoting scripture. Now you have to imagine, this is a man who's been through so much, hanging on to his life. How could he possibly quote the entire Psalm of 22 for you and me? It's just impossible. But what does he do? He quotes the first verse. And here's where the Holy Spirit spoke to me, and I'm sharing it with you now. He also spoke the very last words in that psalm, which was, he has done it. In other words, it is finished. He is the Alpha and Omega of Psalm 22. He quoted it on the cross, the very beginning, those first words, and at the very end, the last final words. They go together. And so with that, let's take the bread, whether you're alone or with a family member, a friend, whatever that might be. We want to remember Jesus, for at the Last Supper, he held up the bread. And after giving thanks, he broke it and he gave it to them. And he said, take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And likewise, Jesus then took the cup and he said, this is the blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of their sins. Now, before you drink, you might be asking, Pastor Lisa, why was a blood sacrifice required? Simple. It's so another messianic prophecy would be fulfilled. For Leviticus 17:11 reads, for the life of a creature is in the blood, and I have given it to you to make atonement for yourselves and on the altar. It is the blood that makes atonement for one's life. So let us drink from the cup of the new covenant supplied by Jesus, the Lamb of God himself, the sacrifice given by our God. Amen. In closing, we want to play a song titled Peter's Song. That's the Apostle Peter. And it's called Face to Face. You see, it pretty much sums up the road, that winding road, remember, that each of us have been traveling on, walking in our lifetimes, and we're still walking it. But now we're not going to walk it alone, are we? You see, this song coming up will not only show you the path and life of Peter, but as he journeys through his relationship with Jesus through his life. It shows you and it shows me what the end of the road is for us. With the Savior of Jesus Christ, it is absolutely imperative that you watch this song so you know what lies ahead, not just today, tomorrow, but for eternity.
Something in the way you called my name. An ordinary fisherman. You called me friend and took me in. How everything had changed. It was then I knew I'd never be the same. Love came and rescued me. I gave up my everything to follow. Now I know all that I was before. It won't matter anymore, for I am a new man. 'Cause I have seen my Savior face to face. I recall standing in the courtyard by the fire. Words still ringing in my head. Three times before the break of morn, you would be denied. And yet I saw no judgment in your eyes. Love came and died for me. I gave up my everything to follow. Now I know all that I was before is dead and it lives no more, for I am a new man, 'cause I have seen my Savior face to face. The dark night,
end of our program, there will be information on how to contact us if you need prayer. So let us know how you're doing, and especially if you found comfort in saying the prayer during the program today. We want you to stay connected so you're not alone on your winding road. We here at Living Word in Silver Spring, we wish you an excellent Passover, Good Friday, and a Resurrection Sunday.